the only way to conquer fear is to just go through it. Believe you've got it.
अब क्या बोलेगी घर पे?
Hi.
मेरी वेलिंग आ रही
है। Oh my God, just like a skateboard.
A skateboard?
Can't be skating like that in the middle of the streets.
Doesn't matter where you go in the world, everybody hates skateboards.
If I can see it, I believe it's done.
I want to build a skate park.
Do what I want.
उन लाखों लड़कियों को इस सवाल का जवाब मिल जाएगा कि वो क्या बनना चाहती हैं.
There was no limit to stars in the sky. Straight from the heart, ready to fight. No one can stop me.
स्केटिंग ही तो लाइफ में एक अच्छी चीज हुई.
लड़कों को चीज से क्यों खेल रही है?
यही सिखाया.
स्केटिंग में इतना क्या अच्छा लगता है?
लगता है कुछ ऐसा है जो कोई रोक टोक नहीं है, कोई रूल्स नहीं है. I'm not afraid,
It is incredible how one small step can just completely change the course of someone's life.
No school.
No skateboarding.
Yeah! No school!
No! इसका मतलब अगर तुम स्कूल नहीं जाओगे तो स्केटिंग नहीं कर सकते.
ठीक यार, रोज कैसे कैसे नवे नवे.
That was the trailer of now critically an audience-acclaimed debut feature film of writer-director Manjari Makijany. After making three critically acclaimed shorts, I See You, The Corner Table and The Last Marble, Manjari takes a self-assured step as a director with Skater Girl. Skater Girl tells the story of a rural Rajasthani girl named Prerna, played with disarming ease by the debutante Rachel Saanchita Gupta, whose life's passion is to become a skateboarder in a village that knows nothing about it and even scoffs at it. The filmmakers constructed a skate park called Desert Dolphin Skatepark close to a cluster of villages in Khempur-Mavli district near Udaipur, which is now a permanent feature used by children there. The film has been written jointly by Manjari and her sister Vinati, who happen to be the daughters of the well-known Hindi cinema actor McMohan, born Mohan Makijany. Here is Manjari Makijany.
First of all, welcome to Mayank Chhaya Reports. Manjari, it's an absolute pleasure to have you on.
Thank you, Mayank. Thank you for having me.
And I can never think of you without your father, for some reason. He always comes in front of me, so I'm sure he would be thrilled to have his daughters do so well.
Yeah, I wish he was here to see the debut film.
Yeah, sure. Skateboarding and skate park, it would seem on the face of it a very odd theme in the Indian context. How did you two sisters come up with it?
So it was exactly that sort of thought, which was, you know, skating in India, and you know, that was like, I would never think of it because here in LA I see skaters every day, but I discovered that there was a whole skate scene thriving in India, not just in one place but in various places. You know, the first skate park in India was made in Bangalore by Make Life Skate Life and Holy Stoked in I think it was 2013 or 2011. I have to check my research books, but you know, it was a while that it was sort of thriving, and different sort of skate parks sprung up after that. First skate park in Bangalore, There was one in Madhya Pradesh, you know, in Bombay, a skate spot in Delhi, in Calcutta. So there were these various in Kovalam in Kerala. And I realized that it's amazing at what skateboarding was doing in these communities. And that fascinated me on how something so unconventional like skateboarding was kind of like breaking through social barriers and just really uplifting some of these underprivileged communities that it was thriving in. And it started from that sort of seed germ, and that got me pretty excited.
You know, once again, to situate it in a rural setup, and that too in a village in Rajasthan. Now, how does that happen?
So we decided that, you know, if we are making a film on social impact, how cool would it be to actually impact a whole new community? And in our research, we had also come across Skatistan in Afghanistan and a couple of skate parks in other different parts of the world, you know, in underprivileged communities. And somehow it was sort of giving the kids there so much hope and confidence, and that sort of universal thing that skateboarding was doing, the sort of sense of freedom, confidence, and a sense of achievement was pretty universal in all these communities. And that is what got us excited. And we said, well, imagine like if this was done in a new place, could we impact a whole new community? And that is how we decided that, you know, we should make a skate park. It was a crazy ambitious task, you know, because it's not the way filmmaking goes. But we were thinking outside the box, and we really wanted to do something and give back to the community in some way. And we also realized if we are making a feature film for sort of a global audience, that even the skating scene in India would come into the mainstream, because not many people know that skateboarding is a thing in India.
Right. How did you zero in on a village in Rajasthan? I mean, it could be any state, but why
Rajasthan? It could be anywhere. So there were, I mean, I love Rajasthan. It's so beautiful. It's picturesque, you know, and there were three things that we wanted to sort of see in the village, which was one, it has to have access to a lot of schools and kids in and around the villages. So we knew that once we would have a skate park, that it would be put to good use and children could be exposed to skateboarding. And it had to have sort of this rustic rural backdrop, because that was the setting that we wanted to sort of empower. And the third thing was it had to have concrete roads, because not just in the skate park, it should be, you know, also take to street skating. So we did an extensive search over a couple of weeks. Emmanuel, Vinathi, I, and our location manager and the location team, we went across villages in Rajasthan, and I think it was like almost more than 600 miles that we covered in a short span of time, and met various girls there. I had my skateboard in my hand. I would ask girls and boys to step on the skateboard and just to see, you know, what their expressions were like and what that feeling was like. And it was amazing to see those reactions. But we had to sort of fulfill these three prerequisites to be able to zero down. And yeah, and we found that in Khempur, in a little district called Mavli, 45 kilometers from Udaipur.
Describe to me, if you don't mind, maybe perhaps an individual response when you showed them a skateboard. Were they aware of what it was? Or the fact that the wheels underneath was exciting enough?
Most of them weren't. So it was the first time they were stepping on a skateboard. And that's the sort of, essence we try to capture on camera when Prerna steps on the board for the first time. And that sort of sense of like wonder and that just exhilarating feeling was pretty much seen on the face of every kid who stepped on that board. And they would mostly end up giggling after the board would sort of slide off their feet.
Right.
So it was quite cute.
What about the logistics of constructing a skate park on the one hand and then making a whole feature film around it? How did you balance the two?
You know, it's interesting you ask that, because they are two such separate endeavors. I mean, Absolutely. Making a film and constructing a skate park and all the challenges that come with it, from, you know, permissions to sort of securing the land to getting a team together. So that was done almost like it's sort of separate project. It was done in 2018, where we got in touch with 100 Ramps, a Bangalore-based skate park construction company, along with Holy Stoked Collective, who made the first skate park in Bangalore. And they put together an international sort of volunteer team and a construction team. And we had people from France, Belgium, Denmark, Bombay, Bangalore, Delhi, come together. And some of them even made it in the film because we called them back and had them play, the guys who make the skate park in the movie as well. So yeah, so it was an incredible sort of feat. We constructed in the middle of monsoon. So we went over time, over budget, off schedule, and it was quite a learning curve.
Right. Before I come to the theme of the film, quickly a bit about in terms of the ownership of the skate park post the film shoot, etc. Did you hand it over to someone? What happens to this? I'm told it's pretty active even now, right?
It is. Yeah, it is very active. I mean, like I said, it's a whole different endeavor, and we wanted to make sure that it's not something that we create and just sort of leave behind, even though it is for the community to use free of charge. The family set up a trust so that we can continue the efforts on the ground and workshops continue there. We have skate park skating volunteers who come in and do workshops, and they're paid a little stipend so they can carry out sort of still teaching the kids and keeping that momentum going. Of course, now because of the pandemic, we shut down again. But we have hygiene workshops there. We have art workshops there. Kids are coming and doing sort of like dental workshops with different volunteers. So it's a whole ongoing process, and the impact of the Desert Dolphin Skate Park, is hopefully here to stay and continue long beyond the film. And that's pretty rewarding for us.
If you don't mind, tell me a bit about the process between you and Avinithi in developing the script. I presume it's a completely joint effort.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And Avinithi is like worn so many hats for this project. She's the second unit director. She's also the producer, co-writer. I mean, she's also done some stunt double. She's doubled up as a stunt for Prerna in some scenes.
Really?
She's really done quite a few things on this project, and she's done the casting for all the kids in Bombay and around that with Sanjeev. So she's got her hands all over the project. But the process was like very organic. Avinithi and I would sort of be part of the drama team in Jai Hind College. And, also way before that, we would put up skits for the family or be writing the sangeet or the wedding scripts for our cousins. So that shorthand was there, and it naturally translated into our working relationship. And it was very interesting to sort of, I would write a scene, send it to her. She would sort of send me a thing back, and we were just going back and forth, sending each other final draft copies.
Who's the younger of the two?
Avinithi is.
I see. Yeah. Once everything was ready in terms of the writing part of it, would you care to share with me a bit about the challenges of making a film of this theme, which is, like I mentioned, something like this has never been attempted in India. Coming from two youngsters, although you are steeped in the Bombay Hindi cinema scene because of your late and very popular father, Mr. Mohan Makijany, or McMohan, as he was so popularly known. Tell me a bit about what it took for you to put a film of this theme together.
I mean, it was definitely challenging and very ambitious, because we spent from the time, I realized that skating was a thing in India to the time we actually did research and wrote the script and constructed the park, then trained everybody at the park, because the talent we chose were all, the lead were all non-skaters and non-actors. So we had to have a whole 5 months artist residency for them. Then we went off and made the film, did the post-production, pandemic hit, and now here we are. So it was a really sort of long 4.5 year process
to get
this done. And it was done on a tight budget. So, you know, we were an independent film before Netflix picked it up. So it was definitely quite a process to get here.
Tell me about the selection of Rachel. I'm sure you auditioned many more girls too.
Yes.
How did you come upon her?
So we had set out to get a fresh face. We looked at skate communities. We looked at NGOs, you know, government schools and sort of drama clubs and little theater groups. And we really sort of, you know, decided to do a non-traditional casting approach rather than giving off casting calls and just giving them scenes. We wanted to see who is sort of the most natural at getting that, you know, Prerna's character and Ankush's character through. So yeah, we just basically did casting workshops and theater workshops, and that's how we found Rachel after looking at, just overall the kids. We looked at, you know, thousands of kids through all these processes, and then we had a workshop with them to see, you know, can they skate. So there was a little initial skate workshop to see who takes to skating and how are they sort of functioning with just like scene improvs and things like that. So we finally saw Rachel. She was just amazing. I mean, the moment we saw Rachel do some of those scenes in the workshop, we were like, this is the girl. Because we gave her a couple of scenes where we gave her no dialogue. And we said, this is just the emotion, come, emote, and then leave. And she pretty much aced those moments. Right. So,
Did she have any training prior to this, or it's completely
No. This is her first feature film. She's done a short film before, but this is her first. This is her first feature.
Your film has several layers. One of which I'm particularly interested in is, one slice of the film is like a sport film. The way you shot the scenes of the kids skating in the well, mm-hmm. those are pretty difficult scenes to shoot. I'm interested to know how you as a director went about it.
So we had a skate consultant who was also a skate choreographer and our skate cam operator, Brett Novak, and he was the one who sort of, we would take our Arri Mini and just strip it off all the things and make it really like a tiny handheld camera that he could be on the skateboard and film with them to get that fluidity. And so we shot some of the skate scenes like that. And the other stuff we shot sort of on a Ronin and a jib, and really to get that fluid motion for skateboarding. So it was very important that skating is sort of conceived in that dynamic way. But more than anything, also just all the sort of drama elements to be very to capture them in sort of a very natural sort of a very natural way. Yeah.
Right. Since much of it, there are variables when you shoot skate scenes, for instance.
Yeah.
They may not stick to the precise choreography that you had in mind. Was there any improvisation while you were shooting those scenes?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Some of those pieces, you know, we had to do them again and again because the skaters would decide their skate line and they would do it a couple of times and we had to rehearse the camera move with them. And that's how we sort of then, you know, would roll camera and capture those moments. And some of the competition scenes were pretty much shot, you know, verite style, which was, like they would be going and there'd be a couple of cameras capturing different moments kind of like on different lenses and just catching what bits and pieces that we get. So yeah, we would do a couple of runs and then different cameras would grab different things. But that those scenes were challenging to film because it was very hot and we had very limited time. It was a tricky one to shoot the competition.
Right. Since we're talking about filming, I mentioned in my message a particular shot where you have the periphery or the lip of the well contrasted against either a rising sun or a setting sun, I'm not sure.
Setting.
And children emerge. That's a pretty evocative, striking shot. Tell me, I'm personally interested, because I am very visual in my conception of life. How did that come about? What was your conversation with your DOP?
You know, it was Monik shot that shot in, again, a very limited time. And we had, the sun was setting, and it was, we just had, I think we had like 15 minutes to shoot that entire piece. And we had some of the production cars just sort of run, drive back and forth to get the dust going, so we would get a nice sort of backlit space. That was pretty much all shot in natural light as the sun was setting. And it's almost a metaphor for these kids rising, you know, with this newfound power they have. And that was a visual that was set in my mind pretty early on, that this sort of, you know, the community really rises with skateboarding. And that was kind of the germ idea behind that shot. And we tried to achieve that so that, you know, as they walk in, you kind of go up and you see them appearing in their, almost like a new avatar, if you
will. Right. In terms of storyboarding, did you do detailed storyboarding, or much of it was also created on the editing suite?
No. So for this one, we didn't really do storyboards at all. Right. I did kind of like those index cards that you see, you know, in the background.
Right.
Those are from my prep, still sort of hanging there. but yeah, scenes were sort of written out, and detailed shot lists were made, and sort of overhead diagrams were made on how to conceive the shots and how to execute them, and how sort of, you know, the flow of sequence of events would happen. But yeah, Deepa Bhatia, who's my editor, was just incredible, because some of the scenes we really experimented with on the edit table, and that whole process was quite amazing. Yeah.
How was shooting in a Rajasthani village? Was there any cultural pushback? Where did people have misgivings about this urban city slickers coming with their fancy skateboarding ideas?
You know, initially they didn't know what we were doing, and we were obviously two city girls coming into the village and sort of, you know, trying to sort of construct this monstrous skate park. And initially they were like, oh, is this going to be a swimming pool? Is this going to be a parking lot? And they just didn't know what this structure was. And I think just spending like so many months in that village during the construction, people got very familiar with us, and the community of Khempur, and you know, especially Hemant G from Ravla, where the best exotic marigold was shot, was very supportive sort of, you know, in this whole endeavor, and for us to get local support. I mean, we had more than 350 locals who were employed on the project. So they were quite happy that we were there. But yeah, there were definitely rumors on what the structure was going to be. And then once the kids saw the park was constructed and the volunteers skating, they were just blown away. They just wanted to get their sort of hands on a board and just try it. So it was quite amazing to see them, you know, experience that skate park in their village. And now they're so proud. They're super proud. I mean, kids who were not skating before just recently represented Rajasthan in the National Skateboarding Championship. So the local village is quite proud of what the kids are doing there.
Just last couple of things. One is, of course, about the great Wahida Rahman. Tell me about how it was working with someone like that, and of course her role is rather short, but she fits perfectly for what she's doing. How was it working with her?
She was just amazing. It took us a while to sort of get in touch with her. One would imagine that, oh, you know, these kids are from a film family and they have all the access, but we really took time to sort of get in front of her. And then once we did, you know, she heard the pitch in like 10 minutes, she said, yep, I'm doing it. This is an amazing concept, and I would love to be a part of it. So, you know, it was quite amazing. And when we sort of conceived the idea of having this the queen in a cameo, Maharani Gayatri Devi was like the image we had in our head. And
precisely,
we wanted somebody as eloquent and as graceful who could play that. And, you know, we were pretty hell-bent on having Wahida Ji for the role. And even working with her was just incredible. She's so humble and so graceful. Just great energy to have on set.
I presume she has watched the film?
Yes, she has, and she's very happy.
Reaction.
In fact, even when she met the king, she was championing the project and she was telling him about the whole endeavor we are doing. So yeah, she was just naturally very happy.
I presume again, since you live in LA, that's where you intend building a career. Are you looking at anything in India at all, as things, say, for an entirely Hindi movie, for instance?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is also predominantly a Hindi film, even though it's bilingual. And I was pretty sure I wanted to do my debut feature in India. And quite honestly, I just see it as, one big sort of global platform. I mean, the next project could be in Australia or Europe, or I really don't know where the story takes me. But yeah, I'd be absolutely, in fact, the next thing that we are sort of putting together is also set in India. So it's definitely how to make best of both the worlds.
Are you in a position to tease us a bit about your Disney work?
Yeah, absolutely. So this Disney film is releasing on August 13th. It's called Spin, and it's about an Indian American teenage girl, Rhea, who comes of age through music and introduces sort of this beautiful eclectic mix of her music she creates. And mixed with her South Asian culture and where she's grown up, and yeah, it's a lovely film. I hope the audiences enjoy it in August. So, yeah.
Is it fortuitous that both your feature films happen to center on two young girls, or it's just happenstance?
I think it just happens to be that they're both coming of age stories, and they're both, on 15-year-old, 16-year-old girls. And I think just having strong female leads is so important, right, for girls to grow up and see that, whether it's in a rural community or it's an urban setting, just for other girls to see that, here is what is sort of her passion and talent, and she goes after it. And it just sort of dawned on me as I'm doing press for both the projects that they're so similar sort of in, they're both sort of finding their passion and then going after it.
Before I let you go, your personal background has been in filmmaking. Were you trained or you just had an instinct for it?
No, I knew pretty early on I wanted to be a director, but my sort of formal training was really on the job, on the set.
I see.
So I sort of started off as an assistant director and then took a little break and went off and made short films. Short films traveled to festivals and then I assisted some more, and then the feature happened. So yeah, I've been working for almost 13 years. So it's been long in the coming, this feature film, and now that it's happening, it's quite exciting that two films are happening pretty much back to back. So that's a very grateful place to be, and I'm very excited about both of them.
And to conclude, what has been the response from the mainstream Hindi cinema types?
You mean the industry, or?
In Mumbai, directors say in the ilk of Karan Johar, for instance.
Oh, I don't know what has been the industry response, but overall the response has been pretty amazing. And, we've had messages coming in from Brazil, Portugal, and Australia and Mexico and all over the states, and of course it did really well across India. So messages have been pouring in, and really sweet messages of the audience is enjoying the film.